how small steps have molded the design, and so that's why the power of small. This is my office. It's a mid-sized office, about 30 of us, equal number of boys and girls, men and women. But it began really small. In fact, it was just one person in the beginning. The difference between that, the earlier picture, and this is the color of the hair. Yeah? So, and this was in our basement, much informal. You can see that these were the times when you used T-squares and parallels. Now, it's a lot more formal and a lot more comfortable too. That was 14 people in a basement, now we have 30 people in 4,000 square feet of space. So that's a lot more air and better light. So as architects, especially when we begin, we get very small projects. So this in 1990 was a project where a bus shelter had to be converted into a classroom, a large classroom. And it took me 15 days to design and maybe another 15 days to build these walls. And it was a temporary project under a GI sheet roof of a tin sheet roof. But now it's almost become permanent. 30 years later, they love the wall, so they should put a better roof over it. Smaller projects, a watchtower, come watchtower. So what does this teach us? To architects, it teaches us how to work in a team. It teaches us how to look at different materials. It teaches us how to talk to the client and develop a kind of design you feel is unique as well as needed. So the two go together. You don't look at just unique, you don't look at only the needs. And it's still there for the past 25 years, more greenery. But what came the course, and what I call as the seed, the smallest matryoshka for me, being the house we designed for ourselves. We were looking at our site, and we noticed the neighbor had dug for the basement, and he had the best, beautiful, most seductive soil ever possible. See, we get, I get very excited looking at soil. So very excited, and we then and there decided, in our house, we will have a basement. Because I'd done earlier projects, and we said the earth is never enough from a foundation, so we should have a basement. And the basement will give enough earth. So just below your feet, you have materials. And that earth mixed with corridors and a bit of cement, then pressed with hand, with these lovely blocks, we call that comfort stabilized earth blocks. They're sun cured, and voila, you make walls. So this is the basement, much better picture than the earlier one, which is right now no longer the office, it's a TV table and storage. The upper levels are mostly brown and red. That's most of our projects are brown and red. Then, in a smaller plot, we don't go by the area, we work in the volume. Create volume for better air, better light. This way, this is now the section of the whole house, we not only created a home which was comfortable for living, but which also becomes a biological entity. Then they said, now we have a system, we have a place. Can we look at our practice as a mainstream practice, not a boutique practice, not a practice which makes homes for, second homes for very rich, but a practice which is located in the city, as my introduction said, it's within the city. It's building for people who have limited budget. And what should we do for that? So we need to be looking at elements which go, we need to be looking at construction systems, and then addressing the crisis of water and waste, and in future, look at making the buildings as biological systems. So how do we look at the spaces and elements? To give us earth to build with. Then you look at basements, water spaces, lakes, wells, terraces, all these are elements of the construction, but it's also resource generating. So basements, like I've shown you earlier, two in the section, now are with beautiful skylights. Some of them have gardens and vents too. This is a school we did in Coimbatore, and we call it, this has the mother of all basements. We cut the ground all the way, including the sports area. So we have a lot of earth, which was enough for this 1,500 square meter building, plus for future. Then we are working in a project near Mumbai, about 100 kilometers from Mumbai, where we are working for past 10 years with them. So an architect doesn't work for one project, but they also have a huge relationship with the client for a long time. So here, where do we get earth from? Luckily, we decided we would do a recharge structure, allow the water to go underground, and we made a 100 meter by 100 meter by 9 meter deep water structure. And voila, you have all the earth you need, you do all the structures, and that's how they look. And these are earth structures, stepwise structure, in an area where it rains 3,000 mm in 4 months during the monsoons. And these are buildings which are 10 years old now. Then we went into the basement, the space which you never build. Then we go up to the terrace, which is rather a boring space. Can it be smarter? Can it give you energy? Can it give you drinking water? Can it give you food? Can it give you biodiversity? Can it also treat your waste? All this can happen on a terrace, anywhere in India, even in the smallest. Again, this is in our house, San Susi. This is our Matryoshka. The rice is growing and it's being harvested on a terrace. So now we design terraces. We design terraces that they are designed for producing energy, for cleaning your rainwater, for giving you light below, for collecting your rainwater, and space is left for growing food. And the clients do much more. They go further. So there are lots of tomatoes and different things growing, but you are communicating by walking the talk, and that happens on our terrace. Then the next thing we drive into mainstream is how do you train people? So it's not enough that you keep doing the project, it has to go further. You keep researching different materials and you have to provide drawings which would be easier for people to build with, and then the outreach. The training many a times happens at the site. These are not masons. A couple of them are IIT graduates. But they're making their own buildings. Then what happens is, in a village, you also now are developing skill sets which other architects use. So this project in Mumbai, near Mumbai, other architects come and use the skill sets available. So from brick, people are going for CSEBs. You make drawings which the masons can read because it's so clear. You know how many courses you have to do. And at times you make drawings in Hindi. In Madhya Pradesh, I can't send drawings to a village in English, so it's all done in Hindi. And then you talk, and you don't have to, as architects, we also travel, not only Seema, we too travel. And this is in Nigeria. The contractor, Jimmy, comes from Nigeria, works at our office for a month, learns construction. Our architect, Sheel Raj, goes to Nigeria, and they both build this. And they build a great relationship. We still are sending them earth block making machines. An intern from Uganda, Paul, is making earth block homes in Kampala, and similar roofs too. And this is Anna from Porto, Portugal, making earth blocks in Portugal and talking to her friends and developing systems for water treatment. So water is a very important part of a project because it's a crisis we all face hugely. So designing for water and designing for waste are two factors we attend to in great detail nowadays. And also designing problems. So for rainwater harvesting, we have made our own software where we put in how much it rains in that city or the region and how much is the roof area, and it tells you which is the optimum size of the tank. Similarly, we have designed for greywater systems. Whether you want to put it on the terrace or on the ground, we worked it out. And it's a freeware available on the net. We are working at recharging hugely. Otherwise, you are taking water from the undergrounds, especially in a city like Bangalore, where we have gone down to 400 meters deep for water. We are putting straws and drinking it out. We are talking about put straws and let the water go in. And Biome is looking at a future where there will be 1 million wells in Bangalore. Already we have done 0.1 million. But it's also providing jobs for well diggers who come from a village, and now 2-3 villages are supported by the well digging which is happening in Bangalore. And water tables are rising. So this whole idea of making an ecosystem and then looking at waste. You see, we are all waste producers, but we are not. We are also hugely very good producers too. We can add to the society. So we designed a WC pan for Indians. We're the most complicated lot. So we have only 4 kinds of people in the world, those who wash, those who wipe, those who sit, those who squat, and Indians are the most complicated. So we designed a pan which is for the EcoSan system, which corrects urine and fecal matter, and experimented it at home. And now this is used by NGO in Bihar. NGO is Make Pine, and the toilets are called Faidemand Sochale. That means profitable toilets, because they not only give fertilizer, they also do not affect the high water table around the floodplains of Kosi. And these are being put everywhere. Then, look at waste as a resource. Can the buildings be waste sinks? Karakpa stone, Tandu stone, everything other than wasted and thrown around could be used in our ceilings, in our slabs. And so the house itself is taking the waste which you would have thrown elsewhere. Then in this project in Bhopal, we went to the Kabadiwala next door and said, what's the waste you have? He had a lot of aluminium louvers from Indian Railways. The project dragged on for 6 years, and we go back, no more aluminium louvers. Aluminium is reusable, it's gone. And we have fiberglass louvers, broken fiberglass louvers. And we need it, because this is the corner, the south and west, where the paper was being stored in this office, and we needed that area to be cool. So to shade the walls, we have used the louvers, picking it up from the Kabadiwalas. So instead of creating and using new louvers, which would be new materials, which would be aluminium or steel or anything which is all again being extracted, here we are doing using the waste. So looking at the last project, which is of a school, where we're saying now we design a system which can never go waste, it can be reused completely. So start with the design of the system. In here, even the foundation can be reused, except the little foundation for the steel column. So there is stone slabs for the plinth, then there is steel columns, walls of earth, roofs of GI, all of it can be removed because it's all bolted, can be reused. That's the way to the inside. Even the flooring, you can remove it. Here, the marble can't be removed, but this is paving blocks on corridors. So we can remove that, and 5 years later, even corridors would have a huge price. What are we looking at in future? We are looking at the buildings being part of the ecosystem. Here, for a competition project, we gave the idea that we lift up the buildings. So we have very small foundation on steel in the whole place, lift it up about 3 to 4 floors high so the trees and ecosystem moves below, and you're in a better space of better light and ventilation, and the building can cover itself with greenery, and it will be a part of the whole ecosystem. We use windmills to generate power, we will use earth cooling to cool the whole place. And now the clients, they are overboard. They write about us, they write about their experiences, and this is what we're looking for in future. And we're putting some more people inside the office itself who will talk about Biome. Biome Environmental Solutions is the name of our office. Biome means the ecology of the place, and we want to be working at this, and it's been great being with you all, and please thank you.